Play this.
What the time change done to you?
Yeah.
6 o'clock is black is, you know.
Yes, it is.
Yeah. Those folks that can't drive at night, surely they can be driving. Yeah,
comes time to start our Sunday evening service. So thankful for another opportunity to be back in God's house with God's people. We've been here for about an hour or so practicing some songs for Christmas, and someone made the statement they are hard to sing. They certainly are, because we only sing them once a year, you know, and then, you know, it's just a coming and going thing. But we're thankful for some of the words in those songs. Yeah. Oh, beautiful star of Bethlehem. You know, we sang that song several times last year. And you just think about that, a beautiful star of Bethlehem. Who was that? Who was the star of Bethlehem? Who is the star in your life today, tonight? It's our Heavenly Father, I hope and pray. But I hope you've had a good day. We'll ask Brother Roy if he asked God's blessing on this evening service. Brother Roy?
Our kind, righteous Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you, God, for another day upon the face here, Lord. Thy love, thy blessing, thy benefits, O God. Lord, Father, God, where I'd be tonight if it wasn't for thee, the love, the God, that you have for mankind. Not willing that, though, Father, any man go to hell, Father, Lord, but they all may come to repentance. Lord, we pray in this little church that's along the highway down here, 139, that God thou bless, that thou will sanctify, that God it may be a lighthouse. Lord, shine out this community, that people may know that thou art God, Father and Lord. Beside thee there is no other. Now, Lord, I pray that God, that thou bless this service, Lord, the singer, Zion, the testimony, God, and Father, most of all, preach of thy word, that may go out and demonstrate the spirit and power of the Almighty God. Lead us, Lord, in the ways of righteousness for thy name's sake. These things I ask in thy precious name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, brother. Get your hymnal out this evening. Turn to page 6. I want to know more about my Jesus. And that's truly what we've come here this evening for, is to hear the blessed word taught to us and preached to us by our dear pastor, and also to fellowship with the brothers and sisters in Christ. Page 6.
I want no more.
374 for the next election this evening. 374. Press on. It won't be very long. And it certainly won't be, folks. Keep on pressing on for the Lord this evening. Today, before we even leave this service tonight, God said, he's seen enough. He's ready to go home and get his children. Are you ready to go this evening? That's the only answer. You can answer that question yourself. I can answer for you, but I can answer for old Charlie tonight. I'm ready. If the Lord decides to come and get me tonight, come on. I'm ready to go. There's folks over there that I'm longing to see, but I want to see Jesus first of all. Page 313 for the next selection. I have somebody with me. I have Jesus with me this evening, folks.
Because I have a Savior.
accomplishers to play something for us this evening as we all stand in fellowship one to another. There might be some that you haven't shook hands with yet today. Shake hands in fellowship, then we'll have our choir come and sing a couple of songs.
Okay. Page 3.
Mama, job, God.
Get a breath, but that's all right too. We make it a joyful noise unto the Lord. That's all we're going to do. And you know, we're not perfect by no means. We won't be perfect till we get over home to see our perfect Savior. Before we ask our ushers to come this evening, someone might want to stand and testify. Anybody at all this evening?
Brother Charlie, thank you this afternoon. This morning I was looking out that door and the trees and everything, and I thought God has such a beautiful place for us to sit. Behind my house, there's nothing but trees over a creek, and I sat there and I think, God, you're so good.
Yes.
And I just love to look at this time of the year, because the trees is changing or whatever, but I just got such a blessing this morning, just looking out that door with the trees.
Amen.
And you know, I just want to be what he wants me to be.
Sure.
Amen.
So I need your prayers.
Bless you, Shirley. Someone else this evening.
I heard a lot of comments about people standing there talking about that door with the sun coming through. I thought how great it is for the Son of God to come in.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Bless
Amen.
You, Jim. Amen. Someone else.
Jordy, I tremendous and God bless you this morning watching our young brother. His name was going up in the air. hanky there, and we just keep wiping the tears out of his eyes. And you know, I like to get blessed myself, but sometimes I like those overflows.
Sure. Amen.
I tell you, it's the thrill of my heart, yeah, especially with young converts, are yeah. willing to make a show for
Amen.
Jesus Christ.
Amen. 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 Bless you, Gord.
Yeah.
Someone else. If not, I will ask our ushers to come this evening to lift the evening offering for us. We thank you for everything today. Brother Arnold, ask the blessing this evening, please.
Our dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank each and every one of you for coming out to the Lord tonight. Lord, watch over us, take care of us. Lord, watch over the pastor as he prepares his sermon and the ones that are on the highways and the byways, Lord. And now, Lord, it comes time to give back to you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I'd say her fingers are probably getting numb by now. She played for an hour and a half today, but we're so thankful for her and everybody that plays the music here in the church. There were several prayer requests this morning, and we had several back there in our prayer chair while ago, prayer room while ago. You know, God knows all about these requests. You know, I probably forgot a lot of the names already, but my little my memory. But you know, Brother Jim said something just as we left, getting ready to come out. He's talking about Brother John. You know, John hadn't been saved very long. He got sick this morning, and he was saying, what did he say, Jim, about the devil?
Oh, he said the devil's right on.
So that just shows you the devil's still working in this world. He ain't going to give up until the Lord comes back and gets this world, the good Christian people out of it. So keep praying for Brother John and his illness and all those other requests that we had this down through this day. We didn't have the group. Well, Jim can't sing, but the girls can sing. Can't you, Mackenzie? Can't you sing?
Charlie Weather coming up. I wanted to reach out to the church.
Okay.
Some of the people from our church was down helping this spring with the court system when we were giving away things. And Judge Lemon sent us a thank you note. Says Dwayne and Ella, thank you both and your church family for your help with the community cookout. So I just wanted you guys to know.
Amen.
I've been blessed with many things. God's been so good to me. I have family and friends who share in all I do. But if I lose it all and I am left with nothing, if I have the Lord, I know I'll make it through. only reason I live, but oh, what a reason. He's the only reason I live, but oh, what a reason. There's nothing in this world worth living for. It only leaves you empty and longing for more. He's the only reason I live, but oh, what a reason. You may have tried a lot of things to find real happiness, but if you look very long, you'll know it can't be found until you find in this world worth living for. It only leaves you empty and longing for more. He's the only reason I live, but oh, what a reason. He's the only reason I live. He's the only reason I live. He's the only reason I live, but oh, what a reason. Even though my spirit's low, and it seems I can hardly go, but still I see victory. Many times I'm walking by faith, I can't see what lies before me, but still I see victory. I just gotta tell you, Satan, you can't cross a bloodline, because I'm covered by his blood. You may stare and you may fight, but you're gonna lose this battle tonight, 'cause remember, you can't cross the bloodline. Sometimes our battles get hot, and it seems we're fighting a lot. Oh, I remember I'm standing on the rock. Satan, if I were you, I'd turn around and give up too, 'cause I do believe you're bound to lose. I just gotta tell you, Satan, you can't cross the bloodline, because I'm covered by his blood. You may stare and you may fight, but you're gonna lose tonight, 'cause remember, you can't cross the bloodline. You may stare and you may fight, but you're gonna lose this battle tonight, 'cause remember, you can't cross the bloodline. You must remember, you can't cross bloodline.
Anyone else this evening? Brother Aaron's with us this evening. I hope and pray that he's going to sing a couple for us this evening. While he's coming, maybe you want to stand and praise our Heavenly Father this evening.
I'll stand to my Lord again and just say that those two songs that they just sang, he's the only reason I live. And that's true in this life. It's the only reason that I live. And the other song is Can't Cross the Bloodline. Yeah. You know, Satan thinks he can get a hold of you and not let go. And he will.
If you let him.
Trust
Amen.
The Lord. And
Amen.
Call upon God. Greater is he that is in us than he that is in the man. And I love him tonight. And I know what John was talking about. You know, when you get down, you just, I know he was sick this morning too. He just told his wife, he said, as he's going out the church door, he said that, I know it's just the devil fighting me. And so he went straight home, went to bed. And he said, I told me later, he said, I'll be there tonight then if I can be there.
Yeah.
And so that's good.
Amen.
That's a witness to God.
Amen.
G. Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art.
Hey, Don.
How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son, not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation to take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Sing it again. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Somebody mentioned Christmas. Come, they told me, da 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 da. A newborn king to see, da 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 da. Our finest gifts we bring, da 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 da. To lay before the king, da 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 da, da 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 da, da 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 da. So to honor him, da 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 da. When we come, hey Don, again, second verse. Little baby, da 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 da. I am a poor boy too, da 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 da. I have no gift to bring, da 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 da. That's fit to give our king, da 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 da, da 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 da, da 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 da. Shall I play for you, da 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 da, on my drum? Mary nodded. Mary nodded, da 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 da. The ox and lamb kept time, da 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 da. I played my drum for him, da 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 da. I played my best for him, da 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 da. Da 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 da, da 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 da. Then he smiled at me, da 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 da. Me and my drum, fade away. Me and my drum.
Thanks to you all that's done the singing this evening. We certainly appreciate it. Here's our pastor, Brother George, with this evening's message.
Thank you, man. Love you. Anybody else got anything? Testimony? Anyone? It is, yeah. We had Connie up here going and Donnie in the back going. Connie and Donnie. How about it? Are you finished back there? Yeah. All right. Okay. All right. Anyone else?
Bert, we got left the room tonight. My wife, she was showed me something on, I think it was on Facebook. I don't know what part it was. They said, get Christ out of here.
Yeah.
I don't know where it was. I tell you what, that place needs prayer.
Amen.
I mean, if they want to get Christ, I tell you what, it's they're looking like Sodom and Gomorrah each day around here. I mean, I pray for our county, our state, and all that. I tell you what, people, if you're not saved tonight, you can be saved.
Yeah. Amen.
Because today is the day of salvation, not tomorrow. Today is.
Yeah.
Because he can only talk to you one time and knock on that old heart's door. I'm glad he spared my life again.
Amen.
He called me to
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Wow. Wow. Say praise the Lord.
Amen. Anyone else? Amen. Amen. Mm-hmm. I see that. Yeah. Hmm. All right. If you'd like to read with me, I'm going to be reading from the book of Psalms. That's Psalms with a P. The book of Psalms. We're going to read a part of Psalm 137. I'm going to read just a piece of scripture out of the book of Judges as well, but Psalm 137. Thank God for all of you tonight and for what you do. Connie, I thank you for playing the piano.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Don't listen to the devil. You have to hear him sometimes because he's always running his chops, but you don't have to listen to him and believe him, right? So I appreciate you. Psalm 137. By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down, yea, we wept, when we remembered Zion. We hanged our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof. For there they that carried us away captive required of us a song, and they that wasted us required of us mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? If you read the history of these folks, the reason they are here, it's their fault. It is their fault. God sent men. He sent prophets. He sent folks trying to wake them up, but they would not listen. And they did what they chose to do. They did what they wanted to do. When somebody makes the statement, you just do what you want to do, I always think to myself, don't worry, we will. Yeah, I mean, usually people do. You want to do something bad enough, you find a way to do it. And if you want to serve God and you want to serve Him, with all of your heart, to the best of your ability, you will find a way to do that as well. This has nothing to do with you being saved as far as that's what saves you, because it's not. It's His grace and His mercy. We are saved by His grace and His mercy. But when He does save us, the saved person, the regenerated person, the person walking in newness of life is going to want to please His Heavenly Father. You won't always be able to please the church, so you just so well get that out of your mind right now. Or sometimes you won't be able to please the people in the church, but nowhere does it say that we need to please the church or the people in it. We need to be pleasing unto God. Well, we know without the blood of Christ applied to our lives, we're not pleasing to Him. That's hard for some people to chew on. Matter of fact, some people spit it out. They don't even want to hear it, that we cannot be good within ourselves. I'm not saying that somebody could not keep the commandments to the best of their ability, to live under the law as the Old Testament would teach to the best of their ability. But we live in a day of grace, and so if you're trying to get to heaven on good deeds or the law, you miss the boat. There's no way you can do it. You cannot make it to heaven by doing good deeds and good works. But when you are saved, and there are some things that you will do, and there are some things that you will want to do. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. That's the way you should be when you're a preacher, right? Honest? When a preacher steps up in the pulpit and says, I'm telling you the truth. It's like, who was it used to say, Wendy Bagwell. This is the truth with my hand up to God. Well, if a preacher has to tell you that, you probably need to get another preacher, right? But I'll tell you the truth, there are some nights that I'm tired. There are some days that I come home from work and I am tired. Will I always want to be in church? No, but my name's on the sign. If they'd take my name off the sign, would I always want to? I show up. I don't always feel like showing up. I don't always feel like going. And when John was talking this morning, when he was leaving, about how Satan fights, he can use anything to fight us, to battle us. And he will try to discourage us. And he will try with things that really didn't even happen. He's an accuser of the brethren. So what really does, and that's how the song, He Didn't Even Shake My Hands, in the song Excuses, and we were talking about that, Miss Naomi, a couple weeks ago. I had missed her, and she said that, and I know she was joking, but you know, there are times that Satan may say to you, do you know that this person didn't even make their way? They didn't attempt to make their way to shake your hand. They just stood there. You watched them. I did a funeral today, and so it's been a long day. And while I was at the funeral home getting ready to do the funeral, a person that I used to pastor walked right up, and I thought they were going to say something to me, and did not even. How, for the love of God, did this happen? I don't know, but they didn't even recognize me. And he just turned and went on and sat down. Well, then when I said something, she heard my voice. And she turned and looked. And she said, oh, I knew you were going to be here. George, I didn't even recognize you. Satan won't let that one slide with you. What he'll do is you'll be at home and he'll keep saying, you know they saw you. You know they just don't like you. He's an accuser of the brethren. He could stir something up. He will. He's got a big stick and he loves to stir. And he will continue to try to stir that up. He will try to discourage you in any way possible. But there are times that you'll do something yourself. You'll be to blame. It won't be anybody else. You can write this one down. It's going to be your fault sometime. God is going to speak to your heart, and He's going to require something of you, and you're going to say, no, I can't do that. All kids say no, right? Don't you just love it when you say to your child who's in a department store throwing off all the stuff off the shelf, you say, come here now, and they say, no. There's a couple of reasons that didn't happen when I was a kid. One of the biggest reasons was my dad was 6'7" and 350 pounds. So that didn't happen in our house. But another reason was they didn't take us to a store anywhere. We didn't go. Usually we just didn't go. But if you tell God no long enough, and I listened to Brother Brad Harris last night out to Mount Hope, a Bible camp. I went out there and sang, and he preached, and then he drove right straight back home today. But I listened to him talking, and it is the truth. You tell God no long enough, or you tell God you want something long enough, eventually He will back away and leave you to your own devices. And that's what happened to these people. I mean, time after time after, that's what's happened to the United States of America. That's what's happening here. When you tell God to get out, you don't have to tell Him twice. No. Now, we know that not everybody has, but has the majority of people? I believe so, yes, because I believe the church in not just the United States, but in the world, in as far as numbers of people, we are the minority. Yeah. So has, and even some in the minority have chosen to kick God out of different things. They won't come out and tell you that, but there are times that God speaks and the Word of God speaks, and it does not whisper. It speaks loudly, and it will speak, and there are times that we refuse to follow, and we don't listen, and we go on to do our own thing. That's what happened to them. And so here they are in this psalm. They are crying. They're by the rivers of Babylon. They've been carried away captives. Now here they are, captives. And their ancestors, if you read the story of these folks, their ancestors had kind of walked along these same paths as well. And it always seems like we could learn from our history, but sometimes we understand and we get it, but we don't learn. Yeah. And how's proof that you don't learn? Because you do it again. You just do it again. And so here it says, by the rivers of Babylon there, we sat down, yea, we wept. Now, why were they weeping? They were weeping because they longed for something that they used to have. And they don't have it anymore. You know, when a church is really going good, have you ever been in a church that's really been going good? It's a good time to be in that church. And you feel so much love. You feel like everybody loves you. And then maybe God says, okay, it's time for you to leave. Usually when people leave, they leave mad. And it's just how it is, or they move away. But usually you don't see people anymore, or the worst part, it could be this, that their health fails them and they can't make it anymore. But usually people, if they're going to leave, but how about when you're really loving your church and it's going great and God says, now I need you to leave here and go somewhere else. And if that's the case, you argue with God. You say, well, that's not, I really need to go. And I can be quite honest with you there again, because I'm a preacher and I should be, right? We pastored a church once, and in the first year of pastoring, people didn't testify. People didn't much use the altar. And it was heartbreaking to us. And Teresa and I had already pastored for 5 years at another church, 5.5 years we were there. And so here we were at this church, nothing happening. And the pastor of the church where I was called to preach had called and said, you know the people love you here, George. Why don't you come back and be the assistant? Could you believe my uncle would do me that way? But he did. And I said, Dave, I can't do it. And he said, how's your church going? I said, it's not. It's not going. Teresa and I both working jobs through the day. I said, we set up last night. I said, we were probably up till 2 or 3 in the morning talking about how good church is when church is good and how we miss that and how we long for that. I said, but it just seems like nothing is happening. And sure, he's calling from a place that things are going. I was like, come on over. And he said, you can be my assistant pastor. Well, Brad Harris was my assistant pastor one time. I told Dave, my uncle, I said, that'd never work. I said, me and Brad were like peanut butter and jelly. You get the right amount, it goes down good, it tastes good. I said, me and you would be like peanut butter and peanut butter. We would choke them. There's no way they couldn't take 2 Vastines in the pulpit. They couldn't take it. And so we stayed where we were, and God blessed, and that church grew, and we were there for, 2 weeks shy of being 14 years. And God blessed. And when it started, when it took off, oh, man, it was great. It was great. You wanted to be there. You didn't have to beg people. Do you have a testimony? You about had to. I mean, I'd be like, I'd be sitting and waiting. It'd still be people testifying. Here it'd be like 8:30, you know. I mean, you start at 7. Be like people sang. People. We had singers. We had people that would preach. It was going good. But then when you're somewhere where it's not, you call back to mind, man, you remember when we were, that's what these people were doing. They're calling back to, and they're not as willing maybe to say this is our fault or to say, you remember when we didn't listen to God and we got ourselves in trouble, but here they are weeping because they don't have what they used to have. And then it says, we hanged our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof. You know what a willow is. Once, when I first started pastoring a big run, the pastor there had pastored there for 20 years, Brother Bill Colley, and so he had prayed about it, and he felt like it was time for him to step down as pastor, and so I go, and they asked me, and we prayed about it, and we felt like it was time for us to step up, and so one night I came to church like I did tonight without a guitar, and there were musicians there, guitar players, and I'll never forget, Brother Bill met me on the front steps as he was standing there waiting for people to come in the church. He was then from pastor to greeter, and here he was greeting people, and he said, "Where's your harp? Did you hang it on the willow tonight?" Yeah. So what are they saying? You know, they left from playing that harp and they hung it on the willow. Now, that's not why I didn't bring mine here tonight. I'm not whining, crying, complaining, griping, any of that stuff. But there have been times that I didn't much feel like playing. And I got some good guitars, Dwayne. I'd look at them. Satan was fighting so hard and things would just be. And it wasn't that I didn't know God or trust God, but believe it or not, let me tell you something. And this is the truth with my hand up, right? There are times that I disobeyed God. I didn't even have an urge to pick up that guitar and to take it out of the case and look at it. When you're disobedient to God, you can blame the devil for giving you a whipping all you want, but if you're disobedient to God, you're disobedient to His word, don't blame the devil for you getting a whipping from your heavenly Father who loves you and only chastises those that are His children. You got to be able to discern that. If the devil's giving you a hard time because you're going full force for God, then I'm going to tell you what, greater is He that is in you than he that is in the world, and God will help you. But if you're taking a licking tonight because God has requested something of you and you said, "No, I won't do it," then you will end up like these folks. They hung their harps on the willow. They took them and they just hung. There was nothing for them to do with them. Why? For those that carried them away captive said, "Now let's hear one of your songs." That's what Satan does, doesn't he? Yeah. That's what he does. "Now let's hear." And their question was, "How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land?" You can remember this because I'll come back to it just for a minute before I'm done. But in Judges, in chapter 17, right at the time of Samson and all this stuff's going on, and of course then we can read into when one person is gone, when one person dies or passes away, there's always a void and it has to be filled. If there is a simple illustration, if there's a rock in a creek and you pick up the rock and there's a hole and it's a creek and it's got water, the hole's going to be filled with water because now there's a void and it's got to be filled. Anytime you take God out of anything, the world rushes in and it tries to fill that spot. In chapter 17, Samson is dead. Samson being one of those in the book of Judges that we read about, that sure he could have done better, but even believe it or not, he could have done worse. But here he is passed. And the scripture says in verse 6, "In those days there was no king in Israel, but every man did that which was right in his own eyes." What gets you to hanging your harp on the willow? When you do things that are right in your own eyes without talking to God about it and seeing, is this the right thing for me to do? Now, God loves us so much that, believe it or not, you don't have to look directly in the Bible and say, okay, maybe you've played this game before, right? Maybe this has happened to you. "Oh, God, I need help. I'm just praying that you show me just exactly what." And you do that. And so if I were asking God a question right now, His answer to me would be, "Though they dig into hell, then shall mine hand take them." Whoa. God, that's not what I wanted to hear. Oh, God, please answer my prayer right now with whatever. You can have a new Cadillac. Well, that's not written in the Word of God. What am I looking for? I'm looking for what I want to hear. People do things in their own way sometimes, and they expect that I'll apologize for it later. That is a big thing in the world, right? That you just do something, and even if it's wrong, it's easier for you to apologize for it later, and so we'll just apologize. But if God continues to deal and deal and deal, and we don't go the direction He chooses for us to go, hardship's right around the corner. And so here these people are weeping. They're sitting by the river of Babylon, and they could be longing for the Jordan River. You remember when Naaman comes down, he starts naming off all the rivers back in my hometown that are better looking than this dirty old river. But here these folks sit by this river, and they've hung up their musical instruments, and the enemy is making fun of them. This is a warning to you tonight. If you walk opposite of what God has for you, this is what you can expect. And what happens after a while is it wears on you to the point where you don't have the joy of the Lord residing inside anymore. I'm not saying you're not saved, but I'm telling you, if you can't go to church every once in a while and feel good, then the enemy will say to you, what's the sense in going? Because you will start, instead of enjoying the message or agreeing with the message, you will start finding fault with everything in the message, because that is not the way you're choosing to walk any longer. And so what you will do then is you will continue to come, but your heart will be far away, and it'll almost be as those people in the book of Judges that they didn't, there was no king, so every man did that which was right in his own eyes. And when that starts happening, and I could ask you tonight, and you could be honest with me, and you could raise your hand to God and say, I do know people who once were great warriors for God, who never go to church any longer, who never have a desire to, who you cannot speak to them about it. Why? Because something happens. Is it always their fault? Now, no, I can tell you it's not always their fault. In this situation, this was their fault. It's not always the person's fault. But it's not just about going to church, folks. It's about the going to church is just a sidebar to the relationship you have in your heart with God. It's just, I want to live in the house with Teresa because Teresa is in my heart. She's the love of my life. So I want to live in the house with her. Well, when you've got God in your heart and you want to live right with Him, there are going to be things that you have desires for, bent towards worshiping Him. And one of them will be going to church. But this is not a going to church or not going to church message. This is a message of, if you are not careful, Satan will whisper to you that you don't need to follow the Lord. And then once he's done that to you, like he did these people, and he's got you sitting off somewhere pouting, he will come and mock you then and say, now pick up that guitar and play me a tune. Now sit down at the piano and play me a tune. Now go get the spoons out of the kitchen drainer and play me a tune. Whatever it is you're, now play me something. And your question will be, how can I praise God in this mess I'm in now? And that's what happens with people when they backslide. And some denominations would say that it's not possible, because if you really have a relationship with God, you don't lose that. But folks, I'm telling you, if you lose the joy, look at all the people you could influence. Now, this right here touches home to a lot of people, and people don't like to hear this sometimes, but I have preached powerful messages to people in the church that I've pastored, knowing not knowing everything in their life, but knowing that it was for, you got 120 or 130 people sitting in a congregation, and God has given you something you've wrestled with all week long. I never say, God, I'm not preaching that, or God, please change it, or I don't want to, because I always think to myself, it's His word, it's His message, and even when it kicks my shins and steps on my toes, it's still His word. But when you're preaching that, and you can feel that going to them, and you can feel them soaking it up, and when you are warning people, when I've warned people from the pulpit, you have lost family members that are going to die and go to hell, and they won't listen to anybody but you, and you are on the wrong path, and you come to church and claim to be right with God, you need to pray about it and get it straightened up tonight, because if grandma or grandpa dies and they wouldn't listen to me because I'm just the preacher that yells at them from the pulpit, but they would have listened to you, but you decided to do your own thing. You say, George, is it that serious? It is that serious. It's more serious than just going to church. It's this serious. You walk the path. You follow what God has for you because you are very influential to people all around you. I can't go into it. Because I wouldn't be right, and he may never see it, but I saw a gentleman last night who said something about my father, and my father's been gone since 1989, but this gentleman knew him before he was a Christian, and then knew him after he got saved, and still last night broke down and cried about my dad's death 30 years ago. And he said to me, I am making something for you, and I've been making it for a long time, and it's in memory of your father, but it is for you that I'm making this. And he said, and when I pick it up to work on it, he said, I just break down. And I thought to myself, I wonder if my dad ever knew he was that kind of an influence on that man. Let me tell you what Satan does. He wants to make sure you know that you don't influence anyone. That no one sees you, that you are invisible. You're a ghost. No one cares if you go to church or not. No one cares if you miss church or not. And that is not true. That's not true. I got a message last night. I was, believe it or not, I mean, even we were up early yesterday and we stay up late. And even, you know, I got to work and Teresa got to go get Addie and all that stuff. But we stay up late. I just think, you know, you're going to have to live. If you're going to be here and exist, you got to have a little bit of time. And so usually it's when you go home, like when you go home tonight, I'll go home and I don't know what I'll have, whatever Teresa graces me with, I'll eat. But I'll go home and be able to rest and relax. But last night, man, it was 9 o'clock. I got home from that thing. I got there and I said, man, I'm sleepy. And so by 9, we were in bed asleep. By about 11:05, I get up this morning and I see from one of my brothers that there was a message that I needed to check on someone. And I appreciate that because I am not all-knowing and all-seeing, and I do forget. And I called that person this morning and we had a good talk. And I just thought to myself after that conversation and dealing with folks who can't always get out, Satan's job is to just come and say, no one cares. No one cares. And he won't reverse it and show you in a time like this that this was their own fault, why they were there. But you know what he'll do? He'll blame God. Now where's your God? I prayed at the end of this funeral today that I've seen funerals will do certain things to people, but death always changes you. It always changes you. If you're mean and nasty and hard to get along with, it may make you soft. It may soften your heart. If you're soft and you're nice to get along with, a death of a loved one may harden your heart. Or it may make you worse either way, whatever direction you were. But it always, you can't get away from a death of a loved one changing you in some way. But you know what happens? One big thing happens as Satan comes in at the death of anyone close to you. And if you are a Christian, and even if you're not, but if you are a Christian, he comes and he begins to whisper in your ear. And hear the preachers up there, and Roy, you'll experience it tomorrow, I'm sure, with helping with the funeral. No matter what the person's life was here, you're speaking to a group of people. Satan fought today in that service, and there was nothing bad or wrong happened. Just in my mind and the words to come out, I thought to myself, God, help me to say something that will help these folks and even the people who do not believe and who think this is just a storybook or a fairy tale. You've got to make your own choice. Right. But what Satan will do is say to you, yeah, your loved one died. He's going home to his family tonight. You're going home without your loved one. If God loved you, he never would have let that happen. And he attacks you. So I'm just saying to you tonight, if you find yourself in a situation where you are listening to the things that Satan is saying to you, check, examine. If it's your fault, pray and ask God to forgive you and ask him to help you. If it is not your fault, realize that he is going to continue to do that until the day you die. The alternative is you don't walk with God and he comes and picks on you anyhow. How would you rather have it? Yeah, Satan could say, oh, they're asleep. Walk real quiet. We don't want to wake him up. We don't want to wake that guy up over there and get him to realize what kind of power he really has with God. Satan don't want you to think God loves you at all. Brother Ronnie said, I like to say I love the Lord tonight. And I almost stopped him and said, Brother Ronnie, the Lord would like to say he loves you too. Because he does. He does. For us to proclaim that we love him here in front of all these people, that's great. He proclaimed it to us. Send his son. He loves us. And Satan will say, if he hasn't already been saying it to you tonight sitting here, he will say it on the way home or he'll say it tomorrow. God don't care about you. And that's a lie. And some of you here tonight could be doing things, but you won't and you aren't maybe. And you've got it hung up on the willow. And say, how can I sing or praise God? How can I work for God if he only knew what was going on in my life? Well, God does know what's going on there. Stand with me tonight, if you will. I have Miss Connie come to the piano and play us just a piece of invitation. If you're here tonight and you would like to pray, we'd love to pray with you. I listened to a guy on the radio. I listen to a lot of radio. I drive a lot. And the guy was talking about how it is in churches that people come up and the preacher says, come up and let us pray with you and we'll gather around you and pray. And he was kind of, and he was a preacher. He was giving out the word, but he was kind of mocking that whole scenario. You know what I like to do? That's all right. Keep on mocking. And I will say it again. If you'd like to come and pray, there are people that are here. It won't be in your living room tonight or in your bedroom praying with you, but we're here. And if you'd like to come and pray tonight, we'll pray with you. Because I always think there's strength in numbers. You can get a call on the prayer chain. That's great. Get a call on the prayer chain. You hear Miss Sherry. You hear Miss Emily, whoever is there, and they tell you, pray for this person, and we're all praying wherever we are. We don't have to be here. We just happen to be here tonight, don't we? Yeah. Sometimes just a pat on the back. Sometimes just a getting up from the altar, wiping your tears, and Connie's playing Victory in Jesus. Sometimes just knowing that you ain't the only one that hung your harp on the willow at one time. Someone else has done it. Someone else has been there. And someone else can help pray for you. As she plays tonight, if you're here with the need, would you come?